This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takacs, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takacs, your podcast co-host. We have an episode for you today that I think you're really going to enjoy. It's titled A, B, and C Patients. I'll share lots of information with you on that I think you'll be able to apply in your practice. But hey, before I get to that podcast episode, a couple of quick announcements to make. Hey, the first announcement that I have is coming up about a month from the time this episode is published, we have our next Thriving Dentist Masterclass. This one is coming up on July 27th on a Wednesday evening, 7 to 10 p.m., 3 hours of content. And it is titled The $2.5 Million Practice Model. The $2.5 Million Practice Model. In that masterclass, I'm going to go through a blueprint on that $2.5 million practice model. Now, let me state, there are many successful practice models. But this is one that tends to resonate with a lot of dentists. It would be two doctors. It could be an owner doctor and an associate. It could be an owner doctor partnered. It could be a partner situation. Strong hygiene department to go along with that. And it's a model that I've had the opportunity to apply with many of my clients. And it's been a model that leads to a practice that truly is a thriving practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction. In any case, come join us. The masterclass concept is 3 hours in length. It allows me to do a deep dive into a more narrow topic, and this topic is that practice model. If you'd like to register, go to thrivingdentist.com/masterclass. Our masterclasses do sell out. Even though it's virtual, I limit attendance because we're running more like a workshop than a lecture. So if there's seats available, come attend. Very inexpensive, less than $90, maybe the least expensive CE you'll ever participate in. And it'll be very practical, things you can use the next day. Hey, the next announcement that I have is we have a top clinical tip today. Today from Dr. Rupert Monkhouse. He is a dentist from London, England. And Dr. Monkhouse has a great tip. He talks about removable prosthodontics. And he's going to share a great tip about how to start a case in the primary impression stage. You know, removable has become a little bit of a lost art, and it's one that could use a little bit of revival. There's lots of patients that can benefit from removable prosthetic dentistry. I think you're going to enjoy what Dr. Rupert Monkhouse has to say. With no further ado, here's the top clinical tip from Dr. Rupert Monkhouse.
Hi there, my name is Rupert Monkhouse and I'm a general dentist in London, UK. I have a particular interest in removable prosthodontics and share a lot of that online on Instagram with my Dentist Rupert handle. And I also run my own podcast called the Impression Club Live podcast, which started off mainly about dentures, but is now transformed into covering all aspects of general dentistry. And I have guests from around the UK and also some international guests as well. I'm honored to have been asked to do a top tip, clinical tip for you guys today. And mine is about removable prosthodontics and in particular, how to start off your cases at the primary impression stage. And we always recommend to build an impression rather than taking one, i.e. bearing in mind that any stock tray isn't going to fit a patient's mouth. It's a generic stock tray and the need to adapt that to get your case off to the best start is crucial. I use a lot of things to do this, but I'm a big fan of using silicone putty. Of course, there's other things that you can use, compound and green stick and such, but I think it's really important to make sure that any edentulous areas you're treating as if it's a complete denture, and you need to get that to fit the tray a lot better. So any edentulous spaces or the palate, for instance, I'll always put a bit of putty there first to get that nicely supported before then having a thinner, more uniform layer of my wash material, whether it's an alginate or a silicone. I think that's the crucial way of getting your cases off to the best start. And we always recommend that, and we're teaching that on our courses coming soon, the Impression Club Impression Course. I think that would be my best top tip. it can, yes, seem like a little bit of a faff compared to just putting alginate straight into a stock tray, for example. But every little error that happens at the start gets magnified throughout the 4, 5, 6 visits of constructing dentures, particularly complete dentures. So I think any little marginal gain you can get at the start is crucial. So that would be my top tip. I hope you found that useful. If you did, be sure to check out some of my content online, Dentist Rupert, and maybe check out the Impression Club Live podcast as well. Thanks.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Coaching in Action segment. This is Naren, your co-host. First, I want to take a minute to thank Dr. Monkhaus for that wonderful tip. We really appreciate Dr. Monkhaus for this tip, and hope you benefit from this. And if you like the tip, feel free to share it with your friends. His Instagram handle is Dentist Rupert. The topic today is A, B, and C patients. Gary has coached more than 2,200 practices, and in his work, working with all these practices over the last 42 years, he had noticed that not all patients are the same, you know, from the point of view of what's good for you and your team long term. So he has, you know, helped categorize patients in three categories, A, B, and C. Today, he's going to define that. He's going to get into, you know, the how do you find out who your A, B, and C patients. And also, he's going to touch on, like, as you think about reducing insurance dependence or creating a practice that patients love to go to, which means more A patients, how do you navigate all of that? So Gary, let's have some fun today.
I said in the opening that our goal, for example, when doctors attend that masterclass, that $2.5 million model masterclass, is the end result of having a thriving practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction. And personal satisfaction is where you're taking care of patients you enjoy, surrounded by a team you love. And so it kind of ties into this idea of categorizing your patients. The reality is not all patients are the same. They're not all the same. I'd like to think that all patients have good in them, Naren.
Yeah.
That at some level, all patients have some good in them, but they're not all the same. And it occurred to me that it might be useful to do an episode around this and kind of talk about the different categories. I was first introduced to the concept many, many years ago by Dr. Pankey. And he didn't use the A, B, and C analogy. He called them level 1, 2, 3, and 4. And he had very specific clinical definitions for patients that fit in each one of those categories. And I decided to make it a little bit more simple here and look at three broad stroke categories of patients. I want to make a disclaimer statement, first of all, Naren, and that's that as a general kind of rule of thumb, it's a good idea not to be judgmental. Would you agree with that as perhaps a business concept, a leadership concept, a value system concept? Would you agree with that principle of generally trying to be non-judgmental?
Absolutely. I think where this helps, this idea of A, B, and C is, so you understand as a whole, you know, how many or what percentage of your patients are A, B, and C, but you shouldn't use it to, hey, he's a C, so I'm going to treat him like a C, right, and she's an A, and I'm going to treat him like an A. I think that's not a good idea.
I'd encourage you to treat all patients the way you'd like to be treated.
Right.
But with that said, I think categorization can be useful, you know, in a practice. And it's a little bit of a tightrope walking act. We strive to be non-judgmental.
Right.
Meet patients where they are. That's another Dr. Pankey concept. Meet people where they are. Because sometimes, and many times, I would say, that a patient could come into the office with a very low level of dental IQ, and over time, develop into a patient with a very high level of dental IQ. So, but I'm categorizing them based on their behaviors, based on the behaviors that we've witnessed, you know, in your practice. They're still good people. Let me be clear about that. But I'm categorizing based on their behaviors. And one particular application that you brought up, Naren, was, recently I was asked by one of my clients, I I'm on the journey to drop PPO plans in my practice. And I'm thinking I want to go all the way. I want to go all the way to fee-for-service. We're still working on that, you know, exact process in his practice, but we're working on becoming fee-for-service. And he's a very analytical dentist, like many dentists are. On the DISC scale, he's a high C. He's an engineer, you know, the engineer personality. He said, I'm trying to forecast how many patients I might lose when I drop these plans. And it's an inexact science to forecast that because you don't know. But it occurred to me that perhaps we could look at categories of patients and use that as a way to provide some kind of a forecast on who might stay and who might go. So let's use the A, B, and C categories. And let me spend a few minutes talking about the kind of patients that would be in each category. Let's go ahead and start with the A's. So your A patients would be those, I'll use some descriptives here. They're the patients that show up to their appointments on time. They reappoint for their next hygiene appointment. They pay their bills. They respond to your treatment recommendations. They follow your home care instructions. They are likely to be patients that refer others into your practice. And they're likely patients that have written five-star reviews on Google or other platforms, singing your praises. They are our bluebird patients. That was another term I heard described many years ago from Dr. Pankey. They're our bluebird patients. They're the ones that we just love to see. We see their name on the schedule, and we know we're going to have a good day when we see them. The truth is, we wish all of our patients were A patients. But I've not met a practice where every patient is an A patient. I've yet to meet that in my experience. We wish they were all A patients. Is there anything else you would add to that category of A patients, Naren, with your experience working with dentists?
Yeah, I think the other thing I want to add is, like you touched on DISC, right? So a way a person with high D might behave might be different from, let's say, a way a person with low D but high S and C behaves. So just because somebody is not agrarious or friendly or gives you a hug doesn't mean they're not an A patient. So how do you kind of navigate that? Because, you know, sometimes you can't judge a book by the cover.
Yeah. Well, they may not, if they have a low I, they may not be social, outgoing, gregarious type of patients, but you're going to watch their behavior. They show up on time. Mm-hmm. They keep their appointments. They are in your schedule in the future because they value dentistry. And that's another thing. They value what you do for them. The right. A patients value what you do for them.
They keep the appointments, you know.
Many will express it in words, yeah. Especially if they have a higher I. Right. You know, thank you, doctor. I had some apprehension coming in here, and man, I have to tell you, I feel very differently about going to the dentist, and I have you to thank for that. You know, you'll hear things like that. But if you don't hear it necessarily, you see it in their behavior. Mm-hmm. You see it in their behavior. So those are the A's, and the A's, we wish our entire practice was populated with A's, but I've yet to see that. So let's go to the B's.
Right.
The B's are also good patients. I'm using the, you know, a very broad descriptive. They're good patients. They generally show up on time. They pay their bills. Make their next appointments and generally keep, they might change an appointment. If they change an appointment, they tend to honor our request to give us at least 48 hours notice. They accept your treatment, but they might have to have it phased in over time. So maybe they're more of a patient that moves slower through a treatment plan for whatever reason, but they're likely to proceed through a treatment plan. They will also follow your home care instructions. They're interested in their mouth. They may refer others, but likely not as much as an A patient. And they may write reviews, but perhaps not as much of the love letter reviews that we get from the A patient. But they'll likely write five-star favorable reviews. And they're very good patients. They're just not quite as good as the A's. Very good, but very good patients all the same. Does that make sense, Naren, when I think about that, when I've described the B's?
Absolutely, it does. I guess my only question is there like one thing that clearly differentiates an A from a B? I know you're saying that they're not as good, but is there like one thing that, you know, perhaps that in your mind just jumps out and say, you know what, this is a B?
The one thing that does jump out for me is that they tend to be patients that think more in terms of phases of treatment instead of getting to the finish line quickly.
Okay.
And that's not bad. That's not bad.
Right.
Because, you know, the great thing with the materials we have today, Dr. John Coyce teaches this, Frank Spear teaches this as well, that with the materials we have today, almost every case can be phased in with the long-term provisional materials we have. Mm-hmm. Almost every case can be phased in. I mean, you love the patient that and that would be the A, yes, that says, "Doc, I'm on board and I want to get this done as soon as possible." Yeah, we love that.
Right.
But the B's will be more likely to say, I do want to get great health, but I may need to phase this in over time. And that would be the one thing that maybe would be the differentiator between the A and the B patient. There could be others, but that would be one that kind of jumps out. Now let's go to the C. C patients, and they are, by virtue of this categorization, you know, they're at the bottom of the ladder of our patients. And they're, you know, they, what are their behaviors? What are their characteristics? Oftentimes we only see them in an emergency. They'll come in under emergency treatment. Something's going on. Something's happening.
That's very unique to C's, right? You don't see that in A's and B's.
It can happen with A's and B's.
Very rarely.
But it's more likely that they've been an avoider. They've avoided going to the dentist. Now they can't avoid it any longer because they're in pain, and now they show up. And they want you to fix them. They want you to. A more common behavior in A's and B's is that they see you as a partner in their health, and they want to participate in that as well. You know, they don't use those kind of words, but that's what we see in them.
So in other words, they take responsibility for their own health.
Yeah. The C's, you know, they look for you to be a fixer. You're a tooth fixer.
Right. Like my car is broke. Its engine has seized. Now somehow make the car run again.
Yeah. And I needed to get to work next week. So let's go, you know. So the C patients, some behaviors that we often see is they often give excuses for reappointing for the next hygiene appointment. I don't know what I'm doing in 6 months. You know, I don't know what I'm doing in 3 months, 4 months. So they are not likely to reappoint. At a very core level, they value dentistry in the way that getting out of pain. They don't value it at a greater level, you know, of how it can tie into their overall health and how truly, you know, good dental health has so many benefits. They don't necessarily see those. And they will often break appointments, another behavior that we notice. And they are also often very insurance dependent. They're the kind of patient that if you're participating with a plan, if you're a preferred provider, PPO, I'm only interested in having this done if my insurance pays for it. That's a common reaction that we hear from, from C patients.
Right.
Doc, I'm only interested in having this done in my insurance. I have this insurance. If my insurance will pay it, let's do it. That's that kind of approach that a C patient is more likely to have.
Right.
Now, let me tie this back to the forecasting challenge. You know, my client that said, Gary, I know it's an inexact science, but I want to kind of forecast what might happen, you know, when I drop these plans. And so we went through a very detailed exercise of doctor and team putting the patients in these different categories, A's, B's. They did a number of team meetings where together they did that. And by the way, they didn't always match up in every case with what the doctor thought was an A patient and what the team thought. They sometimes varied. And then they talk about it and decide where to put the patient. The truth is there could be A minus patients and B plus patients. B minus patients, C plus patients. There's gray is my point. And when in doubt, we gave them the benefit of being the better patient. If anybody saw something that gave us a hint that this might be, quote, a better, I know I'm using judgmental language here and I'm struggling with that. But the better patient, we gave them the benefit. If some team members thought they were a B minus, And doctor thought maybe a C plus, we put him in the B minus category. And so then we had the entire practice categorized. It happened over a series of team meetings. And what we found in my coaching work, specifically in regards to who stays in the practice when you go out of network, typically what will happen is you'll keep your A's. They aren't going anywhere. They're your evangelists. They're the ones that love you. They're the ones that move. You know, think about some cities near and there where people move around a lot. And yes, someone might move 30 minutes. Well, think of Mississauga. They might move to Toronto, and it's not that far, but it could take an hour to get there with the traffic, right?
Yes.
But they stay in your practice because they value you. They're the A's. So when you go out of network, you're going to lose. You're going to keep the A's. You'll keep the B's, and you're likely to lose the C's in your practice. Now, every time we've done this in my client base, it's been reassuring to go through this categorization because we're able to look at the composition of the patients and do some forecasting on what might happen and who we might keep in there. Because you can say, well, how many active patients do you have? And that's a number that's useful to evaluate this, but it isn't just how many active patients would be defined as having had an appointment in your office in the last 18 months. But within that group, out of that active patients, where do they stand? Are they A's, B's, or C's? You know, here's some other abstract ways of looking at it. The A patients will often bring in gifts. It sounds kind of odd, Naren, but they'll bring in bakery during the holiday season.
Yeah.
Right? And the A plus patients won't even have an appointment. And they'll show up in your office with baked goods. Or yes, with homemade tamales. And boy, we just love that. You know, just love patients like that. You know, just another way to look at it, you know, from a not an analytical way of what behaviors do they have. You know, very often those referral patterns are very good to look at. They'll be the ones that refer all their coworkers, you know, into your practice, the A's. So you'll keep the A's, you'll keep the B's, and you'll lose the C's in a very broad, simplistic definition. And by the way, it doesn't usually break out in even proportions in the practice. Like a third are A's, third are B's, a third are C's. It doesn't usually shake out that way at all. It's usually a different mix. And so then you can take a look at it and see, well, before I go out of network, is there anything I could do with the C's to move them up a category to be more likely to keep them? Is there anything I can do? And that's a useful exercise to go through as well. But I thought it'd be useful to talk about, you know, not all patients are equal. Their behaviors aren't all the same. They don't look at you and your team in the same way. They don't look at dentistry in the same way. One thing you can do is you can cultivate more A's in your practice. You can absolutely cultivate them. Let them know you love seeing new patients. Naren, let me just show you an exercise we could do, any of our listeners could do. Naren, let's say you're a patient, you're an A in our practice, and I'm the doctor. I might say, you know, Naren, I don't know if I've ever expressed to you how much I appreciate you being part of our patient family, but please know I have deep appreciation for you as a patient. You know, when I see your name on my schedule, I know I'm going to have a good day. And Naren, just so you know, we do welcome new patients in the practice, and I would always make room for friends of Naren. It's a simple request. By the way, that is likely to land very well on an A patient. Because it's true. It's all true and accurate.
Yeah.
Right?
Genuine.
It's genuine. It's real. Of course, if it happened, you know, hey Naren, I knew you were on my schedule today. I wanted to make sure I said thanks. A couple weeks ago, we saw your friend Dave. And Dave mentioned that he's here because of you. And I wanted to say thank you personally for sending Dave to us. I appreciate your trust and confidence. Thank you. We're going to take great care of Dave. And thank you for the confidence. And so it's things like that that you can do to cultivate You know, are you going to do that? Are you going to have the same conversation to a patient that we only see on an emergency? It's ingenuine. It doesn't land the same way. It sounds canned and quaint.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, I hope this discussion has been useful. Think about your patients. Think about how you categorize. And also, let me bring it back full circle. And let's still strive to be non-judgmental. And let's observe, you know, our patients. Let's meet them where they are. Let's carry a message of hope. One of the messages I think is a useful conversation for all of our patients is always have a hopeful message that their dental health can be better, that their health can be better, their experience at a dental office can be better. And it's a message of hope that I think tends to resonate very well with people. Well, I looked ahead and I saw we have some great questions from our listeners in the Q&A. Sam, we'll go a lot deeper in those questions. But I hope you find this episode useful, the topic useful, and start to think about your patient base a little bit different. Think about what you do with this knowledge to really be offensive and intentional about how you design your practice so that you end up with more A patients. It's all about your intention. All right, let's hit pause here and we'll go into the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment. We talked about A, B, and C patients. In today's Q&A segment, I'm going to pick four questions from our listeners. Gary, let me ask you the first question. What has been your experience in successfully moving patients from one category to another?
Well, first of all, let me say that it is entirely possible that people move from categories both ways, up and down.
Right.
You know, so it does happen. It does happen. And obviously, the movement that we want to have happen is we move them up.
You know, you're saying people change as opposed to...
Yeah, people change. You know, people change. Priorities change. Circumstances change. Right. Life events change. So one of the comments I wanted to make that maybe is a good place to insert this here is the reason I like to be non-judgmental or strive to be non-judgmental with patients is that we often don't have the full story. We don't know what else is going on in their life that might affect their behaviors.
Right.
Like, for example, you may interpret a patient as very dour and grumpy. And you may want to just automatically, you know, make judgment about that when in fact, you know, that person may have experienced some grief recently in their life, which would explain the dour, grumpy temperament.
Yeah.
Right. So it's always useful to say, I don't, you know, in your mind to say, I don't know the full story, but we can interpret their behaviors. And that's what I'm talking about in terms of putting them in the category. We're not judging them as a person. We're just looking at their behaviors. You know, the patient that only comes when something hurts, that's a behavior. That's not a, it's not a character judgment.
Yeah.
So with that said, we want to move people up, you know, go from C to B, go from B to A. Now, Dr. Panky used to say, people can change. And he'd have that in big, bold letters. This is before we had PowerPoint and Keynote. He would have overhead transparencies. Do you remember those, Nair?
Yes, I do. I do.
He would have overhead, and he'd have in big, bold letters, people can change. And then underneath it, he'd say, but not very much. It would be a little tiny print, but not very much. And he said, that's just been my observation, that people, so they tend to move a little bit at a time. But yes, you can absolutely, my experience has been, you can move people along. And sometimes you can do that by being very intentional about asking questions and listening to the patient, you know, truly slowing down, getting to know the patient and asking appropriate questions. Dr. Reed, Omar Reed, who you've all heard me talk about on the show many times, Dr. Reed wouldn't use this all the time, but with the right patient at the right time, he might just ask you, you know, Naren, it occurred to me that I've never asked you, I need to apologize. I've never asked you a question that I would like to know the answer to. Is it okay if I ask you that question?
Absolutely.
And what are you going to say every time?
Yes.
Naren, and again, I apologize for not asking you this sooner, but my question is simple, but it's important. How healthy would you like to be? And then literally he would zip it up and listen.
Right.
And the vast majority of time, what do you think most people said?
All the way.
Well, all the way, Doc. Now, sometimes they would qualify it. You know, they put a qualifier on it, like, well, I'd like to be healthy, Doc, but I do have to be mindful of budget. Okay. That's a fair answer.
Yes.
That's a fair answer. But nobody ever said, you know, not really, maybe a little bit healthy. You know, they never said that because that is an answer that, you know, I don't think anybody would naturally respond that way. So you can move people along in these categories. Absolutely. And part of it is to praise when they're seeing good behavior. Like, let's say a patient historically didn't make their next hygiene appointment. And now they've been 2 years and they come back. You know, people vote with their feet. Have you ever heard that saying, Aaron?
Yes.
They vote with their feet. What do I mean by that in a dental office? They show up.
Yes.
They're participating. And so, you know, I always like to, because oftentimes the patient's like, I'm so embarrassed. I haven't been here in a couple of years. And you actually look at it and it's been 3 or 4 or 5 years, you know. But now they're here. And then if they make their next appointment, they're sort of showing you a change in behavior. So I think one of the best ways we can motivate change in behavior is to recognize a commitment on part of the patient and praise them for it. And do it in an appropriate way with the patient, because it'll often result in more of that kind of behavior.
Thank you, Gary.
Great question. But my observation and experience has been that people do move, and we can have some influence on moving them up.
I like the second one too. I have found it useful to involve my team members when we categorize patients. Sometimes they have perspective one way or another that is very useful. What are your thoughts?
Oh, absolutely. I love that comment and question. Absolutely. And sometimes, it can be disturbing, try not to let it bother you, but patients will treat your team differently than they'll treat the dentist. Sometimes that is a behavior that we see among patients.
Right.
They can be sweet as sugar with the doc and then surly, you know, with a team member. But it can also be the team member might also have more information about, you know, patient behavior. So I think it's very useful to include the team and then talk about it. So, oh, well, why do you see it that way? Tell me more. And that's a great answer. Tell me more. You know, that's the language we're using with our team member. You know, right. So let's say, you know, a team member says, I think George is more like a B minus. Tell me more.
Right.
And listen, actually listen. Wow. I never saw it that way. And then just decide. Let's decide. Let's decide where to put them. You know, it's casual. I mean, we're not, it's not like it's, we're putting them in jail or anything.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. But I would absolutely involve the team because it becomes a more comprehensive process and it gives you more input because oftentimes team members will have a lot more interactions with patients than sometimes a doctor does. Yeah, very good.
Thank you, Gary. Let me ask the third question. We see quite a few new emergency patients who are able to get them and we are able to get them out of pain and they vanish. Any thoughts about how we might retain more of these patients?
Great question. And, you know, I always look at that emergency patient as an opportunity, because if you can get them out of pain, which of course we usually can with the technology and skills we have in dentistry today, we can get them out of pain. You're a hero. Now, in the eyes of the patient, right? You're an absolute hero. You got them out of pain.
Yes.
And you can say something like this. If it was you, Naren, and I was the dentist, I could say something like this. You know, Naren, I'm glad that we had a chance to take care of you today. I'm sorry you were experiencing pain earlier today. It was great that we could get you out of pain. And I would like to talk to you and invite you to become a regular patient in our practice. Today, you were an emergency patient. And I'm glad we could accommodate you today. But I would like to talk to you about how to come into our practice as a regular patient so that we could do some things to avoid these kind of things from happening in the future. How's that sound to you?
That's wonderful. That's great.
I would love that. I never want to have this happen again. Usually it's a fairly, you know, spirited conversation in a positive way.
Right.
And then we can say, and we invite them, invite them. Leanne Brady, who you all know, or hope you all know as a podcast listener. Lee is a very dear friend. She's my CEO and clinical director at the Pankey Institute. And I think the world of Lee. Lee uses invitation in a similar context, but a little bit different. She invites patients into a conversation about comprehensive care. When you're invited to something, isn't that generally a cool thing, Naren?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Because we are choosing to participate. So of course,
and now we are
committed to it, right? So like we said yes.
Yeah. And you generally appreciate the thought that you're invited.
Yes.
Like, hey, Naren, we do a book club with our client. I'd like to invite you to participate with the book club. How's that sound to you? Oh, great. What's the book?
Right.
Right? So you're invited. I like the words. I think the words we use are important. But invite that patient, that emergency patient, invite that patient to join the practice as a regular patient. Hey, today we saw you as an emergency patient. And I'm glad we could. I'm glad we could accommodate you and get you out of pain. But I'd love to see on a regular basis as a regular patient, so that we could maybe identify these things, see what we could do to keep this type of thing from happening in the future. How's that sound to you? Sounds really good.
Sounds great.
And so I look at those as opportunities instead of, you know, while, you know, they're a low quality patient because they haven't been to a dentist in 10 years. The other thing is the patient that hasn't been to the dentist in many years, on one hand, we could judge them. I mean, we try not to be judgmental, but we could judge them and say, well, they don't have a high dental IQ. But on the other hand, guess what the byproduct of not going to the dentist for a long time was?
They have a lot of dentistry.
They have a lot of deferred maintenance going on. A lot of deferred maintenance. And I mean, you know, just from a business standpoint, forget the human side of it for a minute, which, you know, we never want you to do to forget the human side, but just for fun, forget that. What would you rather see? You know, a 21-year-old young adult that's never had a cavity in their life as a new patient in your practice, or the 50-year-old patient that hasn't been to the dentist in 15 years? I'll take the latter.
Yes.
From an opportunity standpoint, I'll take the latter patient.
Right.
You bet. And it's deferred maintenance. And they kind of get it. You know, even if things aren't hurting, they get that things aren't right. You know, it's like, what would happen if you didn't take your car in, you know, for 15 years of maintenance? You wouldn't expect it to be very reliable. And, you know, I'd rather see that from a business standpoint, production standpoint, I'd rather see that latter patient. Of course, we love seeing the 21-year-old that's never had a cavity, and we hope we can continue that. But I think the idea we can absolutely have those emergency visits. That's why, you know, some offices, Naren, this might be a good question for you in regards to search engine, organic search engine optimization. You know, is emergency words, you know, emergent, what kind of keywords would you use if you want to attract emergency patients?
Absolutely. The number one keyword, of course, is emergency dentist, open late, open now, open on the weekend, you know, pain, like dentistry pain, like they're in pain, they're trying to find someone they can go to. There's all kinds of keywords. So what we do is we use something called Google Analytics, and we look at our other clients who do a lot. I mean, a lot of our clients target the emergency patients for the very same reason that you talked about, Gary. They have a lot of work. And as long as you can build a relationship and you can get them out of pain, they do stay loyal.
They can.
So I think the challenge, what I have heard from our clients is, you have to understand why they didn't go to a dentist. Sometimes it's because they're afraid of going to a dentist. You know, they're afraid of the needle or something like that. So if you have a solution for that, then, you know, that might really help.
I'll role play with you, Naren. If I'm the dentist,
yeah,
should I be including those kind of keywords in our plan together? I mean, should
absolutely.
I?
Absolutely. Exactly. So those could be some of the keywords, you know, painless, pain-free. And the beautiful thing about Google is we give them one idea and Google will give us 25 ideas
toothache,
based on actual data.
Toothache.
Yeah, exactly. Toothache is a classic keyword because, you know, they literally have pain right now, you know.
Right.
And then the way we do it is we look at the keywords that get the most amount of people typing it in. So we want to target the ones that will give the biggest bang for the buck.
Right. A great texture to that conversation, Aaron. I think a lot of dentists think that, well, you know, should I include that kind of those kind of keywords and key phrases, or should I be going more for the high value services like dental implants and adult orthodontics and cosmetic dentistry? And a lot of it depends on the practice and depends on where your range of services are, you know, in the practice, what you provide. But it could be a very useful way to grow patients in your practice. And you could embrace the concept of let's work on getting them to be, you know, a loyal, frequent patient in our practice to move up the ladder in these categories.
Absolutely. Let me ask you the last question, Gary. Are there any services my practice may offer to attract more A and B patients?
So, again, this kind of is a continuation of what we were just talking about. And that is that we could look at the range of high value services offered in your practice. And those could be incorporated in our organic SEO. And those could be likely to bring in patients that were higher in the dental IQ patients seeking out those kind of services in your practice. But one of the, this may sound a little bit of contra indicating, but I think one of the opportunities to really grow a practice is to bring patients in by offering oral conscious sedation to make every visit as comfortable as possible. Because first of all, the universe of people that are apprehensive is huge. It's huge. We forget that sometimes because we're so close to it in dentistry. But I'm going to give you the statistics, Darren. 49% of the adults in the United States will put off a visit to the dentist because of apprehension. Wow. 22% won't go at all. Won't go at all because of apprehension. But if they knew that the visit could be comfortable, think about that universe of patients that applies to. And remember, these people typically come with high needs. They come with deferred maintenance.
Right.
That, I mean, recently I looked at one of our clients and we kind of went granular in looking at the details. And we looked at the average case size on a patient that did oral conscious sedation. And the average case size in this practice was $6,800. Now, I think we'd all agree that's not full mouth rehabilitation, but that is a nice case.
Healthy. Yeah. I
mean, and by the way, it was not particularly exotic dentistry in this practice. It was everyday dentistry. It was fillings, root canals, crowns. But it was a lot of them because of the fact that they've been away from the dentist for a while.
Right.
So I personally think that represents a great opportunity. But now you might be thinking, this is the contraindicating part. You might think, well, aren't those C patients if they haven't been to the dentist? Maybe we could change that. You know, maybe their past behavior, you know, was that they didn't go. And maybe we are the tipping point for them. Your experience in your office is the tipping point that now they become a loyal patient. And they, you know, one of the best indicators of that is whether you're successful scheduling the next hygiene appointment and whether they show up for the next hygiene appointment. Right. Now they're voting with their feet. And now they're saying, yeah, you know what? I want oral health to be something I'm more paying more attention to these days.
Mm-hmm.
And those patients can become quite zealous about their positive experience in your practice. They'll go out and tell everybody. And they'll tell people like, hey, I was the guy that didn't go to the dentist for a while. And man, I am so happy I found this office. Because I am much different today. And I'm much healthier as a result of that. And I'm singing it from the rooftops. Right? Now I am being a little idealistic in that, you know, that sequencing, but it could happen, right?
Absolutely.
So I might suggest that the answer to that question could lie in some cases, high-value services that you're offering in your practice. And in other cases, incorporate oral conscious sedation. You know, the nice thing about oral conscious sedation is you can make every visit comfortable for patients. And once they learn that, they can become very good patients. Let me piggyback on that for just a second, Aaron. One of the dynamics that I notice in many of our clients' offices is that we'll see more women in the practice than men. Now, that's not universally true, but I have seen that happen. And I think there's a reason for it. Women tend to be more faithful about healthcare appointments by nature of their behavior. They tend to be more faithful. So in many practices, we're seeing the wife, but we're not seeing the husband. And right. So when you see that, you might say to the patient, Linda, I notice that we never see your husband, Dave. Now, if we're a relationship-driven practice, we know her husband's name, even though he's not a patient of ours, right?
Yes, absolutely.
Linda, I notice we don't see your husband, Dave. Does Dave have a dentist? And it might be, oh yeah, he goes one to one near his work. Well, fine, leave it there. But if Linda says what we commonly hear, I love the guy, but he's a dental knucklehead. He's afraid of going to the dentist, and I can't get him to go. So we might say to Linda, please let Dave know that we provide oral conscious sedation to make every visit comfortable for him. We'd love to see Dave as a patient if he's ready. And now all of a sudden she could be the person that really converts that and brings in a patient. And he'll likely be a patient with high needs because you haven't seen him. He hasn't been at the dentist in 15 years. Well, let's put a ribbon on this one. I hope you've appreciated the discussion about A, B, and C patients. Those questions were great. Let me thank our listeners for submitting those questions. Thank you so much. They add lots of texture and detail. Hey, as we wrap up, I want to say thanks to our listeners. Naren, thank you for co-hosting the webinar with me. Thanks for all the support that you and your team at Equa provide. You're our marketing agency. Thank you for all of that. And I get to see your work with all of our clients as well. I recommend Equa to our clients and I get to see the great work there as well. Also want to thank our listeners. We truly appreciate each and every, we love what we do at the Thriving Dentist Show. But we're always mindful of the fact that we couldn't do it without you. Thank you for the privilege of your time. And we look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.